Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. And at question number one, I call Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Small Business Minister has had with ministerial colleagues regarding an assessment of the total number of self-catering properties in Scotland since the introduction of its short-term let licensing scheme.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
The introduction of short-term licensing in Scotland means data is now being collected on the numbers of short-term lets, including how many are self-catering. The Scottish Government is publishing quarterly statistics about this data that provides the number and status of licence applications and the number of licences in operation and additional information such as location. The latest publication was back on the 20th of November and that covered the quarter ending on the 30th of June. So I have, as Small Business Minister, liaised closely with my ministerial colleagues across other portfolio areas, including tourism, about short-term let licensing, and an update will be provided to Parliament on its implementation in early 2024.
Finlay Carson.
Yeah, thank the Minister for that response. Scotland's self-catering businesses play an integral role in Scotland's tourism sector, generating in the region of £1 billion. Undeniably, a vital part of the economy in rural areas like mine. But the introduction of numerous new regulations has dented confidence and has done little to support this vital industry. Does the Minister not agree with me that the Scottish Government should not seek to reduce short-term lets, holiday lets, as a means to solving current rural housing challenges, but instead focus on understanding rural housing needs and building more affordable homes, a budget that was slashed this week in the budget?
Minister.
Well, the Member raises so many different issues there. I'm just trying to work out where to start, but can I start off on the point of agreement, which is that in terms of the self-catering sector, it does absolutely play an integral role in Scotland's tourism offering and our local economies. The Member will also be aware that many countries and many cities across the world, in light of where technology has taken us in terms of tourism and Airbnb and so on and so forth, have been reviewing the regulation around self-catering lets and short-term lets. And I hope the Member agrees that it's necessary to do that. Now, in terms of the trends in Scotland, we're paying very close attention to this. And as I've said to the Member, the Government has pledged to bring forward an update to implementation in early 2024. And, of course, we'll look at any issues arisen at that point. And, of course, the latest statistics will be published in due course, and that will give us a better picture of where things are.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister won't be surprised to hear that the introduction of short-term lets legislation has presented particular challenges in island communities like the one I represent. In some of the smaller isles in particular, it could see the removal of any accommodation that is integral not just to the tourism sector, but for public sector workers, for tradespeople who are out visiting, undertaking work. As he takes forward the review that he's talked about in terms of the statistics, will he keep an open mind to the possibility of introducing a degree of extra flexibility for the way in which this legislation operates in our island communities?
Minister.
I thank Liam MacArthur for raising that point. Of course, I'm looking at this from a small business and tourism perspective, and my colleague Paul McLennan, the Housing Minister, will be bringing forward the update and implementation in early 2024 as pledged. And of course, there's a variety of issues again arise from Liam MacArthur's question that affect the island communities in Orkney and his constituency, such as the need to make available more affordable housing, and there's a number of measures been taken by the government in relation to second homes and so on and so forth, to try and address some of these pressures that are affecting our island communities and our rural communities, and that does a knock-on impact for key workers as well. And Paul McLennan and myself held a summit in Pitlochry just last week with a number of businesses and organisations from across the Highlands and Islands and indeed the south of Scotland to discuss the pressure on key worker housing and affordable housing in rural areas and the impact that has for local economies. So I just want to assure Liam MacArthur that these issues are at the top of our agenda.
Thank you. Question two is not lodged. Question three, I call Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the steps that it's taking to tackle loss and damage in marginalised communities.
Cabinet Secretary Mary McCallum.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Colin Beattie for the question, because loss and damage that's being experienced in communities throughout the world is perhaps the single greatest injustice at the heart of the climate crisis. The Scottish Government has now pledged a total of £10 million to addressing loss and damage in climate vulnerable communities. Our initial pledges have been mobilised in programmes directly in the Pacific, in Bangladesh and in Malawi, and we've now begun work funding, operationalising the funding announced by the First Minister in September, and that in Kenya, Ethiopia, Pakistan and Zambia. All of our programmes, they take a participatory approach, which means that we consult directly with communities and we look to support the most vulnerable people within the most vulnerable communities.
Colin Beattie.
It's encouraging to see that the Scottish Government is committed to making the Loss and Damage Fund a success and that Scotland has played an important part. Can the Cabinet Secretary say any more about the steps the Scottish Government can take to encourage other countries to commit the finance needed to address this challenge?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yes, Scotland's membership of international fora such as the Under 2 Coalition, in which we're the European co-chair, and regions, this allows us to both demonstrate the action that we've taken but also encourage action on loss and damage from our colleagues. In addition to this, through the practical action that we're taking, we've helped to leverage funding from philanthropies, such as the match funding we received from the Open Society Foundation for our non-economic loss and damage programme. Ultimately, Scotland's action at COP26, standing beside the Global South, who've been campaigning on this for three decades and helping to break the impasse on loss and damage, has since seen pledges for this specific issue unlocked to the tune of $700 million. That is to be welcome, Presiding Officer, but when we consider the need and the number of recipients throughout the world, that number has to increase and increase very quickly.
Thank you. Question number four, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what recent engagement it has had with Scottish mountain rescue teams regarding mountain safety this winter.
Minister Marie Todd.
Winter in Scotland's hills and mountains offer incredible experiences to enjoy the outdoors and to reap the physical and mental well-being benefits. The Scottish Government continues to engage regularly with the Chair of Scottish Mountain Rescue and with the spokesman for the three independent teams at Glencoe, Lochaber and Cairngorm about a range of issues affecting mountain rescue teams across Scotland. We're very supportive of this year's hashtag ThinkWinter campaign, which was recently launched. The campaign encourages people to plan ahead, to think about winter conditions before heading out in the hills, and provides an online resource with links to all of the information needed for exceptional mountain adventures.
Liz Smith.
Can I thank the Minister and can I also welcome the campaign? Improving accessibility and the use of technology has obviously considerably increased the number of people who are visiting Scotland's mountains, which is a very good thing, but unsurprisingly that has led to an increasing number of emergency call-outs for injured and lost walkers. It was 698 in 2021 and 709 in 2022, and alarmingly that's about a 30% increase on pre-pandemic levels. So can I ask what the Scottish Government is doing to ensure the sustainability of the service and to support its members, most of whom are volunteers, of course, so that they can continue to provide their life-saving service?
Minister.
So, firstly, let me agree with Liz Smith. It is a life-saving service provided largely by volunteers with a passion for the mountains, and for that I'm grateful. They also help us with critical incidents, so we're crucial in the response to storms recently in the east of our country. So, a really incredible service. In order to support them, we give them an annual grant of £312,000 to Scottish Mountain Rescue. Sport Scotland invests over £2 million into the safety of mountain users. That includes approximately 1.5 or 1635,000 for Glenmore Lodge and some 379,000 for the Sport Scotland Avalanche Information Service. We do also help to coordinate with all of the interested stakeholders. So it's not just the mountain rescue teams. There are a number of interested stakeholders. And as you say, there's been a rise in people enjoying our mountains, from mountain biking to skiing. And we are keen to support that to happen safely.
Thank you. Question 5 has been withdrawn and question 6 is not lodged. Therefore, we move on to question 7. And I call Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its budget will affect East Kilbride.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robinson.
This is a Scottish budget that is set in difficult circumstances where we're having to deal with a 1.2% real terms decrease in our block grant since 2022-23, and that has forced us to make difficult decisions and prioritise what really matters. East Kilbride communities will benefit from the increased investment in the NHS, from the additional £1 billion we're investing in social security benefits, the increased funding for our police and fire services, and from record funding to local government. A 6% increase from last year's budget, including additional investment to fund a council tax freeze. These are the choices we've made to support people and public services across Scotland. Colette Stevenson.
I thank the Deputy First Minister for that response. 13 years of Tory austerity is eroding funding for public services. On top of that, Scotland is still paying off Labour's dodgy PFI deals. This includes Heremeyer's Hospital in East Kilbride, which cost £68 million to build over 20 years ago. But the PFI debt is £28.7 million this year and £29 million next year, with a total repayment exceeding £700 million.
Let's hear Ms. Stevenson.
In the face of these budget constraints caused by the Labour and Conservative parties, can the Deputy First Minister set out the benefits of the SNP government's progressive income tax policies, including for spending on vital public services like our NHS?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. Can I say to Colette Stevenson, in stark contrast to the opposition...
Members, let's hear one another.
Well, they don't like to hear it, no, presiding officer. In stark contrast to opposition parties, this government is fully committed to the principle of progressive taxation and continuing to support a social contract with the people of Scotland. The Scottish Fiscal Commission have estimated that our income tax policy choices since devolution will raise roughly an additional £1.5 billion in 2024-25 compared to if we had matched UK government policy. And as a result of our progressive approach, we can continue to provide a wide range of services and social security payments not provided elsewhere in the UK, such as our flagship Scottish Child Payment, free prescriptions and free higher education, benefiting our society and people across the country.
Graham Simpson.
Thank you. Strathclyde Partnership for Transport works across the region, including East Kilbride, and the Deputy First Minister has just slashed its general capital support grant to nothing. That funds engineering works, bus station works, bus stops and shelters, bus infrastructure, decarbonisation of fleet, and supports councils to deliver active travel. Does the Deputy First Minister agree with SPT Chair and SNP Councillor Stephen Dornan when he says this is completely unacceptable?
Cabinet Secretary.
Oh, I think Graham Simpson comes here with crocodile tears when his government has cut capital funding by 10% over the next 5 years. Yeah. If Graham Simpson actually cared about our infrastructure, then he would be making representations to his own Tory government about such cuts. So we've had to take difficult decisions, and what we have done in making those decisions have taken into account the reserves held by organisations like SPT. So we'll continue to work with organisations, but where they have reserves, that of course is taken into account in the budget decisions that we have made.
Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the reference by the Cabinet Secretary herself to the general impacts of the budget, and taking into account the proposed increase in the capital budget for health, can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that a new medical centre for Lochgelly was in fact promised by the Scottish Government way back in 2011? And surely, therefore, the Cabinet Secretary must agree with my constituents that it should be Lochgelly's turn now.
Cabinet Secretary.
What I can say to Annabel Ewing is that, of course, our investment in health services, both in terms of infrastructure and frontline services, is of key importance. I said in response to questions in the budget statement on Tuesday that I would be coming back in the spring to set out our investment pipeline based on those priorities, but also taking into account the capital cuts from the UK government that will have an impact on infrastructure. But I'm happy to continue to engage with Annabel Ewing to make sure that I update her in due course on the particular facility that she referred to.
Thank you. Question number 8, Evelyn Tweed.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with ScotGold Resources Limited regarding any support that can be provided to employees who may lose their jobs at its Clonoonish gold mine near Tyndrum, in light of the reported announcement that the company has gone into administration.
Richard Lockhead. Thank you, Minister.
Following a petition to wind up, as it's referred to, the Scottish Government's Partnership Action for Continuing Employment, known as the PACE team, contacted ScotGold Resources Limited to offer PACE support for any employees who may be facing redundancy. Through providing skills development and employability support, PACE aims to minimise the time individuals affected by redundancy are out of work. The owners appointed administrators Pitcher Partners in Australia, whom our PACE team also contacted. PACE stands ready to support workers in this and other redundancy situations, and the service can be accessed through SDS Online Services offer and at SDS Centres at Skills Development Scotland for anyone looking for redundancy-related advice.
Evelyn Tweed.
I have been contacted by an employee of ScotGold Resources who, despite being told they are entitled to resign and claim redundancy, has not been paid. What actions can these 80 employees take to ensure they do receive the remuneration they are entitled to?
Minister.
Well, I think we want to agree at the outset that the Scottish Government, of course, wants everyone made redundant to receive all monies owed to them, and I hope that situation is resolved as soon as possible. However, this is a matter for the administrator. Responsibility for dealing with employee claims and insolvency is reserved to the UK Government and is dealt with by the Redundancy Payments Service. If the employer is no longer trading but has not registered as insolvent, individuals might be able to either make a claim to an employment tribunal or contact the Redundancy Payment Service if your employer registers as insolvent later in the process. Individuals can access free advice on their options through the ACAS helpline as well.
Thank you. That concludes general questions, and I suspend this meeting until noon.